in 2000, and in fact we started to work on this in 2015. And beforehand I worked for several years for HBO Europe, making the European version of In Treatment. It's a wonderful format, what I love really very much. So it's just 12 years, but 12 years are extremely long, extremely long, even more if you have a ready script already in 2000, and then the next one and the next one. Well, it happens that so all those years I wasn't making films, I was occupied with trying to make films. That's what happened.
But and this film, was it a surprise for you? Because it has it's been having a great success after the main prize in Berlin. Then you have done many festivals that have continued to being awarded, and then the film is being released in several countries. But it's, how do the audiences usually react? Because this is a film that contains at the same time. So I remember. So at the beginning, you have this scene of the slaughter in the abattoir, and at the same time you have these characters that are of, have an extreme fragility.
That's life. we have it both relay all the time. We have dinner in front of the television that we are watching, so it's just real life. About the reception, I think first,
yeah.
I'm really, really curious about this reception. Anyway, when we started the film, I told my wonderful, wonderful, really wonderful team that, listen guys, this will be a very low-key film. It is not fitting to anime currents. It is a love story, so it's not about a very burning topic, a very important topic of today. It has no any extreme, very auto-like stylistic gesture, so it probably won't go to any major festivals. But we should make it this way, because otherwise we just kill the film. And I'm so thankful for them that they were very involved and very enthusiastic and really very, very focused to the detail. And they knew everybody, from the wonderful cinematographer till the drivers, what we were doing. So I am immensely thankful to them. And perhaps this sort of work resulted that somehow we made a, it seems that it's quite approachable film, because never ever any of my films was sold. In fact, it's sold all over the globe, so it's even for me, it's wow.
But anyhow, you started with a film that was in Cannes, then the next one was in Venice, and so you have then until now four or five films. We can see, and I invite you, we will see two other films by Eddie, we'll see the first one, My 20th Century, November 22 at 4 p.m. here at Monumental, and then Simon the Magician on the 24th. There's any question now?
Congratulations. I would like to know if this movie results from those years writing in therapy. Also, when did you get the idea of two people dreaming the same? And third, how was the experience filming in a slaughterhouse, personally? your experience?
When you asked Slaughterhouse, I forgot the two first questions.
The consequence. This movie is a consequence of writing in therapy.
Oh, in fact, I wrote this script 10 years ago. Then the Hungarian film industry collapsed, and for more than 3 years, there was no production at all. So the good thing is, and afterwards I started to work on in treatment, is the good thing was that I wasn't struggling with this script, it didn't get tired. But in fact, the script was written before my experience with this great, originally Israeli series. If you have the chance to see the original one, it's so amazing to see brave people with a great idea, very simple but very bold idea, and with tiny money, you can see an amazing acting.
Two people dreaming the same.
So, when I started to write, it was very unusually quick and short writing period. Generally, it takes me a year to write a script, and I rewrite a lot, and I throw out a lot. And here it was a big, passionate rush of several weeks. And after 10 years, when, or 8 years when we started, I barely changed the script, which is also quite unusual. And somehow, when I had this first idea, which was rather a feeling, not the plot, to make a film about nearly nothing on the surface and everything beneath the surface. Very quickly I had these two characters, I didn't have to construct them, as many times in writing you make it. I had the feeling I know both of them very well. And I wanted to put them in a situation which is strong enough to push them out of their comfort zone. Because these two people would continue their very closed, shattered life the same way if there was not something which is forcing them out. So just imagine if such thing happens with you, then you just can't walk in the same way the next morning to your workplace and say, oh, hello, and continue to work. You have to do something with it. And really, I swear, I don't know how this idea came to me. In China, they told me that there exists an old Chinese opera of several hundred years where the same thing happens, but there these lovers are in their dreams in the same form, so not in form of animals. And to work in the slaughterhouse, it was a very important experience for us, for the whole crew. Naturally, with the cinematographer, we were there several times beforehand. So before going there, I also wrote a letter for the team. We also sat down and spoke about what is awaiting us, because what I really didn't want is that a bunch of film people from the big town are arriving and they are starting to faint and tell, oh my God, the poor little animals, this sort of complete hypocrisy. And I chose actually this slaughterhouse, especially from the street where we were permitted to get in for shooting, because of the director. He is a self-made man, he was a butcher himself, he is very much aware whom a while, because it's a brutally strong working situation. Just to go in the morning, kill animals for 8 hours, then take a shower and go to the movies or to the disco or whatever. You have to have a very healthy soul just to cope with that. And we found there really wonderful, wonderful people who treated these animals with respect and a sort of fraternity. And they are very far from being intellectual, so it was somehow a natural feeling, and it made me think about those tribal traditions where they went after the animal, they went out for a hunt, they killed the animal, they ate it, and then they thanked it for keeping them alive. So somehow this feeling was very present in the slaughterhouse. And so, I can tell all my intentions, and you spectators can tell if I succeeded or not. We separated the scenes where there were dialogues, where real acting was involved, from the animals. So we used the empty slaughterhouse. I put all the scenes with the actors, with dialogues, all before or after working hours, and not by chance. Because I really didn't want to mix our presence and our very different priorities with the working process there. And we filmed with two cameras, and we didn't want to interfere at all. We just filmed every step. But by choosing what to show and what not, it was, on my part, quite conscious. It was quite conscious to show the face, this very expressive, wonderful face of the cow before being killed. You can see it quite long. Also, we spent a lot of time by filming those moments which has nothing to do, let's say, with the big story. For example, there is the lunch break or a coffee break, and workers are having a cigarette and chit-chatting, and there is just still music in the radio, and the animals are waiting, standing there and waiting silently. So, but jumping back to the process of the killing, I wanted to put the accent on the drama and not on the horror. For example, there is a moment when they cut the animal in two, and the big belly blurs out. It just would cause disgust and horror, and would push us further from this animal, and I wanted to pull you closer to them. That was my intention. I wonder, you asked probably because it wasn't your feeling.
No, I was surprised by the way you told us about your personal experience with this place, because I found it very far from the experience I had watching your representation of this place. So your personal experience surprised me, because I saw something completely different in the way you shoot.
What have you seen?
I don't know. When you talk about tribal traditions and truthfulness, and I don't know. I think that you shot this place and these people as robots, or in, like, people completely detached from their actions, and that the emotions and the sensibility are separated from the things that they do, and that they're not really conscious about what they're doing. I don't know, but maybe it's just my subjectivity. I don't know. So when you talk about tribal traditions and truthfulness and that personal that closeness to the things that you do when you kill animals, and I just have a completely different imaginary.
Well, I the toughest thing was to walk around the animals, the alive animals. It wasn't watching the slaughtering, really. They have to spend 24 hours in there before being killed. That's a regulation. And to see their silence, patience, and the fear in their eyes, because they know that they are in a horrible place. For sure, I didn't show that sort of tenderness, how they spoke to them, how they touched them, even leaned with the whole body to them. You are right. There is no cruelty. For example, in France, there is a new regulation in every slaughterhouse. There has to be cameras, security cameras are there normally for the owner, but for animal rights defenders. Because it happens so often that there is arbitrary, unnecessary cruelty towards these animals. And at that place I understood what is the mechanism behind. It's the same thing that happens in wartime. If this other soldier, this other young man who you have to kill is just an object, then your sin is not so big. So you try to objectify it. And by being cruel, you just prove to yourself, if that can happen, that's really just an object. So instable soul can very, very easily go in several weeks into extreme cruelty. So somehow this sort of lack of cruelty, this sort of sober sobriety, this is what we are doing. That was my intention, and well, for sure not to show the kindness of the workers, but to show the drama that complex being is being killed and not just an object.
Hi. Thank you for coming, and thank you for the film. This isn't really a question, and it's something that you've already answered, but it's could you just say a few words about the title? And I think in the original it's the same, it's a literal translation, the body and soul. But maybe was there some other idea for the title, or was it from the start, the title?
That was the title from the start. Again, very quickly, as quickly I wrote the script, I just gave the title. And for sure, during editing, I questioned it. Perhaps it is a bit new agey. And I was looking for something else. And for 2 weeks, it had another title, I tell you that. It was inspired by a wonderful Hungarian poem, by the way, and it was Straight Labyrinth, because somehow, this is Maria for me. a straight labyrinth. But somehow, this is the film about, this is about not just body and soul, and not their coexistence, but rather that you can't really separate. We are the interference of the two, and really when we mostly showed bodies, for example, the body of the dying animals, what I really wished to refer to, it was rather the soul, it was rather a real compassion towards every being, also human beings. And when, for example, Maria is opening her soul towards this man, she's doing it by a series of experiments, bodily experiences, touching, feeling the sunshine, the power of sunshine on her skin. So somehow the way to open her soul goes through her body, through accepting the touching of another being laying in the grass and so on. So I thought, I just did this title, whatever anybody thinks about it.
Further questions?
Yes, please.
I have a question because I noticed that you're always framing Maria in maybe reflected on glass or actually through the glass itself, and towards the end she breaks this glass so she could use this piece of glass, and I was thinking if you had any intention with this or not.
Wow. I never thought about it. I just wanted there again a moment of truth, that sort of sober practicality of somebody who doesn't just try to get killed herself, but wants it really, because somehow arrived to a wall and she should have to turn back. And it's like somebody who grew up in prison or a camp, and one day they take her by hand and they say, come out, have a look around, how rich is the world? And the next day they drive her back and say, okay, now you saw it, now you stay here for the rest of your life in this prison. So, but thank you. it's this sort of, well, there were several sort